Welcome in. Outkick the coverage. Outkick the show viewers. I hope all of you are having a fantastic Monday wherever you may be across this great land. Rejoice, college football, which has the longest off season in all of sports, has at long last returned. This is week zero. We've got a game between Florida and Miami, and we've got a game between Arizona and Hawaii this weekend. Get your bets in. If you're an Outkick VIP, I'm hoping for a sterling year this year. I've already put up my bets for week zero and week one. You can go check those out on the message board. Lock It In returns today. So shortly after I finish this show, I will move over in my Outkick home studio, sit down in front of the television, and get geared up for another season of Lock It In. Lots to get to, lots to discuss. I want to start with college football, but I want to also tell you off the jump here, wins and losses. My new podcast comes out weekly. Joel Klatt is the guest this week. It's fantastic. I guarantee that you will enjoy it if you haven't watched it or listened to it before. I encourage you to go download. If you haven't, I always like to ask this question. How many of you have actually listened to a Wins and Losses podcast so far? I'm going to keep promoting it because it's exclusive to podcast form. And I'm telling you that I think you guys will really enjoy it. And right now, if you go and give me 5 stars and you make fun of Joel Klatt, we'll track you down and try to get you a t-shirt. So there is a lot going on there, but this week's guest is Joel Klatt. Next week's guest, I'll tell you in advance, will be Rachel Bonetta from Lock It In. So that is where we are headed. We have had a lot of awesome guests. Kirk Herbstreit, Paul Feinbaum. We have had Shannon Terry, founder of 24/7 Sports. Dave Finocchio, who founded Bleacher Report. Bobby Bones. A lot of different pretty outstanding guests. Jason Whitlock, as I try to run through all of them. Long-form conversations. I think you guys will enjoy them. I encourage you to go check it out. All right, news stories that we're following out here. College football. Just had the breakdown that is pretty intriguing. AP Top 25 comes out. And the AP Top 25 comes out. And this is wild. I want to hit you with how much movement we've had at the quarterback position in college football, where we essentially have created perpetual free agency now, especially at the quarterback position. Let me hit you with this. Jalen Hurts has moved from number 2, Alabama, where he was the starter, to number 4, Oklahoma, where he will now be the starter. Justin Fields has moved from number 3, Georgia, I believe, to number 5, Ohio State, where he will now be the starter after being beaten out by Jake Fromm. Jacob Eason is the starting quarterback for number 13, Washington, after he has now been moved because he was beaten out by Jake Fromm. Jacob Eason is at number 13, Washington. Number 7 ranked Michigan has a quarterback in Shea Patterson, who previously was the starting quarterback for Ole Miss. And we also have Kelly Bryant. Mizzou is not ranked, but I believe they would be ranked if they were eligible for postseason play. Kelly Bryant has moved from number 1, Clemson, where he lost his job to Trevor Lawrence, to Mizzou, who I think is a top 25 caliber team. If that is wild, that is how wild that is. I just ran through all those different quarterback moves, and it's pretty extraordinary to think about what has happened in the college football universe, where we effectively have perpetual free agency at the process. Good point. Joe Burrow has moved from, I forgot about Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow has moved from number 5, Ohio State, to number, what is LSU in the AP poll? 6 or 7? To number 6 or 7 there. So that is a wild amount of movement, all in the top 13 that we just hit you with. Mizzou is a top 15 caliber team, I think, as well. So that is the universe that we now live in college football, where there are a lot of different moving parts. But I think college football is the best sport in America. I think it's the most entertaining. I am ecstatic that we are back for week zero. I'll be writing a lot about it at Outkick, doing the starting 11 every single Sunday morning. I will have a big write-up for you. I've got my picks for week zero up. I'll put them up on Outkick on Wednesday, and then I'll put, as I always do, all of my college football picks up every Wednesday, as we've been doing for like 8 years. So that is what is going on in the world of college football. Okay, a lot of other different stories that I want to hit here before I get ready for Lock It In. This is wild. Antonio Brown continues to create insane drama. Now, the reports are that he has shown up for practice today. After not showing up for practice for a long time, continuing this helmet drama, there are 90 players right now on every NFL roster. There are 32 NFL teams. So basic math here, there are 2,880 current active NFL players. Rosters will eventually be cut down to 53, but there are 90 players on each team right now. 2,879 of those players are perfectly comfortable wearing the helmets that are allowed by the NFL. One guy is not, Antonio Brown. And I think what's going on here with AB is this is a great example of a diva wide receiver who has been enabled by the fact that the Oakland Raiders gave him $30 million, traded for him with a third and a fifth round pick, and money has made him more of what he already is. Plus, I think it's possible that if you look at all of the incidents that Antonio Brown has had in like the last year and a half or so, 100 miles an hour in a 45 mile an hour zone, throwing heavy furniture off of a balcony during a dispute that almost hits a kid, could have killed somebody on the ground down below, being sued by multiple people for not paying them, the cryotherapy issue in France, the helmet issue now with the Raiders, fighting with Big Ben, with Mike Tomlin, and with Juju Smith-Schuster, all in an erratic fashion, getting kicked out of practice, not showing up for multiple days, and then showing up on Sunday claiming that you are ready to play. There are all sorts of issues in the mix for Antonio Brown, but I'm starting to wonder whether he has, in addition to a great deal of talent, a great deal of mental difficulty going on right now with some of the hits that he has taken, particularly the big one from Vontaze Burfict. Now, if you study or read League of Denial and have studied up at all on CTE, you know that CTE isn't caused by one big hit or even by a couple of big hits. It's the repetitive hits that build up over time. You also know that CTE is not diagnosable until after you have already died. So that in and of itself is a challenge, but it's hard to look at the way Antonio Brown is behaving right now and say anything other than he looks to be mentally a broken man. And the Raiders have to be wishing they could write off that whole $30 million they have him signed for, get back their third and fifth round picks. If they had this to do all over again, there's no way they would do it. Big Ben, Juju Smith-Schuster, Mike Tomlin, they all have to be laughing. Have you noticed how the Pittsburgh Steelers have been completely under the radar, even as all the fanfare has surrounded Baker Mayfield and OBJ, and even as all of the attention has boiled in on top of Antonio Brown? I think this is a combustible situation for the Raiders. I don't think Derek Carr necessarily is going to handle it that well. I don't think John Gruden will. I don't think Mike Mayock will. Before all is said and done, this is going to be an ugly, ugly situation, I believe, in Oakland. But in the meantime, the AB drama builds. How about Ezekiel Elliott? Our good friend Jerry Jones said after the most recent Dallas Cowboys game, Zeke who? And this was wild because the Cowboys running back, who has gone out and played very well, and nobody foresaw it in the wake of this second preseason game. And that Cowboys running back, whose name I have to look up because I immediately forget. What's this guy's name? Pollard. Pollard, right? Zeke who is the quote. Pollard is a fourth-round pick that nobody expected to be very good. Here are some stats for you. Tony Pollard has averaged 8.4 yards per carry so far this season. through two preseason games. He was the 128th pick overall. He's averaged 6.7 yards per touch. And look, we know that Zeke Elliott is a really, really good player. But if you think about Pollard and what he potentially is capable of, we could have a little bit of a mini version of what happened in Pittsburgh going on last season. If you remember, Le'Veon Bell held out, refused to sign his contract. The team all gathered around James Conner and said, we want to be able to have as much support for James Conner as we possibly can. Conner was set to make, I believe, right at $500,000, about 1/28th of the salary that Le'Veon Bell left on the table as part of his franchise deal. And James Conner went out, and there was almost no difference in his overall performance relative to Le'Veon Bell from a statistical perspective. So the question that I think is interesting about Pollard is his performance diminishing the value that the Dallas Cowboys put forward for Zeke Elliott? And remember, what I think is most intriguing about the Cowboys is Zeke has 2 years left on his deal, and right now, Dak Prescott and Amari Cooper are free agents after this year. So if they have to make a decision about who to pay, and there isn't a lot of money left on the side, because right now Dak Prescott is demanding potentially $40 million, to me the play is to let Zeke continue to stew on the sideline, let Pollard run the football. Unlike all the way back, I think it was in 1993, when Emmitt Smith held out. I'm old enough to remember that. Some of you young guys out there won't remember this at all. But Emmitt Smith held out. Derek Lassick was his backup. And the Dallas Cowboys were a lot worse. They went 1-2, and Emmitt Smith got his money. Will that repeat itself? I don't think so, because I think the NFL has changed so much since 1993 that the overall value of a running back continues to decline precipitously. So if I were Ezekiel Elliott with 2 years left on my deal, I don't know what possible, like, real PowerPoint move he has here, what power play he has in this scenario. I just don't think he's going to be able to make the Dallas Cowboys come off their wallet when in reality, Dak and Amari Cooper are much more substantial assets that they need to have locked up for years to come. So this will be an intriguing story to follow as you continue to move through this preseason. Two preseason games left. Most teams will have their dress rehearsal this weekend, and then they'll do nothing on the final game of the year, which tends to happen, final preseason game of the year, which tends to happen on Thursday. The big story here is that the running back position continues to be diminished, and what we saw with James Conner and Le'Veon Bell is a perfect rationalization of that. You can find a lot of guys in the third, the fourth, the fifth round, potentially undrafted, who can do everything just as well as your stud running back in the first round. I think Ezekiel Elliott knows it. The problem is he's actually been paid pretty well since he's a first-round running back. I would have more concern for him if he had been a late-round running back, come in and dominated and was looking to get paid. I just don't think that's very likely to end up happening. All right? As we continue, more drama. How about Kyler Murray's performance? I know it's the preseason. I know we have to have huge caveats associated with everything connected to the preseason. But that performance that Kyler Murray put forward against a pretty bad, in theory, Raider defense and against a pretty bad, in theory, Raider team has to make the Arizona Cardinals really, really nervous. They basically mortgaged their future on Kyler Murray, and he looked like he was totally unprepared to be a starting quarterback in the NFL in the second week of the preseason. He didn't recognize the blitz. Nobody on their offense knew remotely what was going on the field. As soon as he comes out, you have a situation where the team immediately drives down the field and gets a touchdown under the backup. I think Kyler Murray exaggerated his height. I think he's going to have a lot of difficulty in the NFL. And if you had to assess, and again, I know it's the preseason, all those requisite caveats. If you have to really assess the preseason so far with the rookie quarterbacks, the most criticized rookie quarterback has been by far the best. Daniel Jones, through two games, looks like the real deal. Again, all these caveats with the fact that it's the preseason. Dwayne Haskins had an awful first game, but a pretty decent second game. Kyler Murray, arguably, has been worse than the third best quarterback so far in the NFL. right? We'll see what happens week one, but you got Minshew down with the Jacksonville Jaguars, who's actually looked pretty decent. You've got our boy from Northwestern, Clayton Thorson, who's actually played a lot of minutes for who has he been playing for? I don't even know. I was watching it the other day. It's the Bengals, whoever Thorson has been playing for. Is it the Eagles? The Eagles is who Thorson's been playing for. There are a lot of young quarterbacks that have gotten substantial minutes because so many teams now decide they're not going to play their starters at all. So that offensive line is not very good with Kyler Murray. I'm not sure how well they're going to be able to run their offense, even if it's a great offensive game plan with Cliff Kingsbury, if they can't block. And I think it's a little bit troubling to contemplate what exactly is going to be able to happen. Plus, good point, Jarrett Stidham has looked decent with the New England Patriots. So there's a lot of moving parts with these rookie quarterbacks, but I don't think Kyler Murray has come in and distinguished himself really highly. And again, the most criticized draft pick so far when the draft came out back in April was Daniel Jones going, I believe it was 6th overall to the Giants. And guess what? Daniel Jones has been pretty good so far. The best of all the rookie quarterbacks with a short amount of games to judge him on. Okay, I went to Vegas. I went to Vegas this weekend, had a good time there, had an unbelievable encounter which never happened to me before. I got into the elevator. Staying at Caesars, I was going to meet Todd Furman, Cousin Sal, going out to dinner in Vegas. Get in the elevator. There's a girl on the elevator already. She's dressed, let's just say it, in a scandalous fashion. Now, if you've ever been to Vegas, it's Friday, 5:30, 6 o'clock, whatever it is, it's almost impossible to tell the difference between a girl who goes out to Vegas and wears her naughtiest, skimpiest, most insanely eye-attracting dress, which is a huge percentage of girls who go to Vegas, and actual prostitutes. I walk onto the elevator, go to go hit a button, and immediately this girl propositions me. Propositions me right there. She says, where are you going? I said, I'm going to go eat with a couple of buddies. She says, why don't we go to your hotel room and have sex instead? Got to be honest with you. As much as I would like to be the kind of guy who gets propositioned for sex all the time, it doesn't happen very often. So I'm like, okay, this is a prostitute. What are the odds that, first of all, the elevator isn't going down, no pun intended. It's still going up. We go up a couple of more flights. Guy walks on, and he knows me. He's like, hey, Clay, what's going on? What are the odds that in a Vegas casino, I'm going to get propositioned by a hooker? It's going to be just the two of us in the elevator. Instead of going down like I'm supposed to be doing, no pun intended again, we go up. This girl, the first guy who walks in, knows who I am, and he's like, hey, what's going on? What's up, Clay? And I say, you know what? I say, you know what? This is interesting. But this girl is trying to seduce me. I said, this girl here, she's trying to seduce me. And without skipping a beat, the girl says, I swear to God, the girl says, I'm not trying to solicit you. I'm not trying to seduce you. I'm trying to solicit you. Just a huge shot across the bow here at me, because she's clearly saying, I would never choose to sleep with you, and I certainly wouldn't choose to sleep with you if I had to seduce you and put effort into it, but I'm perfectly fine with taking money from you to have sex with you. So anyway, we eventually ride down the elevator. She goes off into the good night. It was only 5:30 in the afternoon. Early start for her. But I got to say, getting my verb choice corrected by a hooker in a Vegas elevator when I said seduced and she immediately said she was trying to solicit me, I mean, that was a shot across the bow. That was as deflating of a blow as I have gotten in a long time. And by the way, I don't think I've ever been solicited before. I've been to Vegas a bunch of times. And I don't think I've ever had a hooker actually walk up and try to solicit me. Now, one of the storylines here could be a cop. Could have been a cop. And if it's a cop, I just got to say this. I continue to be blown away that our tax dollars would go to allowing somebody to try and catch somebody to commit a crime that they would have otherwise never committed, right? If that's a cop in the elevator, and I am just going down to dinner, and if that cop doesn't try to get me to pay to have sex with her, there's never a crime that's committed. I don't understand how almost every prostitution arrest is not entrapment, right? Like, if you try by offering something illegal to me to get me to do something illegal, which I otherwise would not have done but for your offer to me, that seems like it's crazy to me that it's a crime. And it's even crazier to me that it's our tax dollars. There are people being paid from our tax dollars to pretend to be prostitutes. My thing on all this, drugs that don't kill you, right? Usually kill you. You can get killed by any kind of drug, right? I'm talking about like not heroin, not like opiates, all that stuff. They should be legal. Weed, cocaine, those should be legal drugs. Make them, charge them, tax them, everything else, take all the black market out of it. Prostitution should be legal. You can sell virtually everything in this country. That's what capitalism is. Why not allow prostitution to be legal? And I feel the same way about sports gambling, which is slowly becoming legal across the country. We've tried prohibition. It didn't work. We tried to prohibit liquor. We tried to prohibit beer. It didn't work. Why not go out and actually stop spending trillions of dollars of our tax money to stop things that there are a market for? And I don't see this as partisan. I don't see this as political. I just think it's crazy. And this is a good example. Maybe she was a cop. Maybe she wasn't. But to have somebody who's being paid to try to do that seems utterly insane to me. So I had a good time in Vegas. Got some bets in. Had a good time with Sal and with Todd, which is why, again, we are going to be live on Lock It In here in, about an hour? We are live at 4:30 Eastern, 3:30 Central, 2:30 Mountain, and 1:30 Pacific. If you haven't checked out Lock It In yet, it's me, it's Cousin Sal, it's Todd Furman, it's Rachel Bonetta. We're on FS1. It's a daily sports gambling program. We're going to talk for an hour today. We're going to give you a breakdown of the NFC East. We're going to talk about Antonio Brown and how you make decisions based on him. We're going to be breaking down each of the NFL divisions. By Friday, we'll get you ready for Florida, Miami, and also for Arizona going up against Hawaii. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're here and rolling now. In addition to listening to me from 6 to 9 a.m. Eastern every morning, you can now obviously watch me on Periscope and Facebook. You can hear my weekly podcast, Wins and Losses. This week's guest is Joel Klatt. Next week is Rachel Bonetta. And you can watch me on television. There's not a harder working man in the business. Tomorrow, the anonymous mailbag will be up. I'm writing, I'm talking, and I'm everywhere. My name is Clay Travis. I appreciate all of you. Season 2 is here. Early picks are up for the Outkick VIPs. You can sign up for the Outkick VIP, get an autographed copy of my book, and access to our events. And by the way, some of you guys are making money off the Outkick VIP because you're drinking so much at our events. I'm going to have to start to shut down the bars. Appreciate all of you. My name is Clay Travis. This has been Outkick the Show. I appreciate all of you hanging out. DBAP, unless you need to SBAP. Kisses all around. I'll see you tomorrow.